Everyone has one of these.
It's like your phone graveyard. And with mine, you know, there's like a couple of Kindles and an iPad, at least one. And then there are all these like phones. And once upon a time, these were like the most important things I had. And now they're just sort of in this drawer and I shut it and I hope they kind of go away.
As a scientist, I spend a lot of time in nature, but I'm also a tech geek.
My phone is pretty much my entire life, but it isn't just an environmental problem once I'm done using it.
Around 80% of the greenhouse gas emissions that come from a smartphone occur before it even reaches your hands. On average, Americans swap out their phones every 2 years, and about 1.4 billion phones are produced and sold every year. But where these phones are put together matters as far as how big their energy footprint is. They make these massive trips around the world to be built, assembled, and then shipped. Much of the journey is done on giant container ships that go from country to country for each step of the process. This happens with most things we buy that are made overseas. We often associate smog with our cars, but collectively, these ships can cause the same amount of smog and particulate pollution as all the cars in the world. That's kind of a big deal. Once a phone is put together, it really isn't designed to be taken apart, and that means it's hard to repair.
We are users of electronics. We aren't participants with them anymore. There's a great history of tinkering for many other types of products, cars especially. You know, they have a really, really robust repair and tinkering community that surrounds those. And, you know, like getting underneath their sink and taking things apart and figuring how they work and really feeling confident about that.
Our phones are these futuristic-looking devices. They almost seem like sci-fi. So it's intimidating to open them up and look inside. But fixing your phone isn't impossible. And it could save you a ton of money along with reducing waste. iFixit's Gwendolyn Gay gives tutorials on how to take apart and fix your electronics. So I went to see her to see if she could make this process less scary.
So this is my personal cell phone that I'm
really
going to show you.
Yeah. Okay. How many times have you opened your personal phone?
I've opened it a couple of times, and this is relatively new, so I haven't needed to go in there other than just out of curiosity.
You sure you want to do this before?
You're very worried for me.
No, because you know, like the reason is everything from banking to travel, everything is on my phone.
Right.
And I think that's why we get so nervous about monkeying with it.
I think that holds people back, but I also think the price of the phone holds people back, knowing that you're voiding your warranty. So if you open your phone, this $600 phone, you're just SOL if you don't do it right, right?
Right.
So there are resources if you're brave enough to repair your phone. But what if opening your phone wasn't so complicated in the first place? There actually is a company trying to do exactly this. It's called the Fairphone.
Now, I didn't even know you could actually build a phone like that. Like, you could actually build it, like a Lego set like that. But so that's the Fairphone.
Fairphone. This is actually the second one, Fairphone 2. And they're only available in Europe. And I can actually do, so easy pie, we're already in. And you can take out the battery, just like that.
Wow.
No tools needed.
Okay.
And then the display is very similar. You just unlock it here. And then you can slide the display off.
Really?
So, yeah. And I can do that whole process in less than 20 seconds.
If all I had to do was pull a few tabs to fix my phone, I would be more inclined to fix it myself. Now, the Fairphone has plans in the future to release phones in the US, but with no specific date set, I'll need to figure out another option, like getting rid of my old phones responsibly.
So, okay, let me ask you a different question. Let me ask you a different question. Why don't I want to actually throw this away?
You don't want to throw this away because everything inside here is going to create some kind of waste, and it's going to be toxic waste. And if we're sending it to a place that is recycling it, say, we still don't get everything out of it.
What's the most toxic thing in a phone?
I'd say the battery, for sure. Hmm. If you remove it wrong, it will explode. So you have to take out the battery.
This can blow up if I smash it?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes. Don't do that.
So what do we do with our cell phone graveyards? Now, most of us just hoard them, like I do, because it isn't just as simple as your typical curbside pickup. But there are easy ways to do this. In New York and California, stores that sell you a cell phone are required to accept it back from you for recycling. Companies like Gazelle will even buy your old phones off you. There's also organizations dedicated to mapping out where you can drop your electronics off. Companies like Apple are starting to figure out a better recycling process. They have a robot called Liam that can take apart an iPhone 6 in 11 seconds. That's roughly 1.2 million iPhones per year. The small screws and other components can be used again. Raw materials like silver found in the phone's circuits can be used in solar panels. And the tungsten that makes your phone buzz can be reused in tools.
But what if we could design a phone that just lasted longer? Now, one of the big reasons why we replace our phones is because our batteries just stop holding a charge. Now, imagine your battery charging in minutes instead of hours, and measuring its lifespan in decades rather than just a couple of years.
University of California researchers are starting to turn to 3D printing to make this happen.
There's the potential there that you can basically design the battery to improve its performance. So you could start to play around with design parameters that you just didn't have control over in traditional manufacturing. With 3D printing, if we can now print a battery in any arbitrary shape that we want, what you can do then is design your phone however you want to design the phone, and then fill it, the empty space in there, with your energy storage material.
These batteries would be made using an exciting new compound called graphene. This means we could avoid harmful mining of materials like lithium found in today's batteries. All of this technology is in its early stages, but it could radically transform the lifespan of our electronics.
Look, it's perfectly common in the airline industry to get on a plane that's like 30 years old. You can't possibly imagine making a phone call on a 30-year-old cell phone. You wouldn't even know how to charge it today. And that's the fundamental way we use technology today, in that it's innovating so fast and built in such a way that it actually promotes disposability.
But I think we're actually at a very interesting tipping point. As people become more aware, companies become more sensitive to this issue.
Hey Liam, what are you doing for Earth Day?
So the next big flashy thing with our smartphones might not be better graphics or a faster processor, but instead, making them more sustainable. Ever wondered about the carbon footprint of your smartphone or some amazing materials that could revolutionize your electronics? Head over to climate.universityofcalifornia.edu to find out more.